with the podium application. So what I've been doing is I've been adding some database code to the podium application. Now the original application was called Soapbox, and this is the source code for Soapbox that you can also get off the LVRug GitHub site. But we basically wanted to redo it. And in the course of refactoring it, we have lots of ideas that we want to incorporate into it. And in fact, so many ideas that I'm not sure if it's ever actually going to be completed. But it's going to be very interesting doing it. We're going to learn a lot doing it. So I think Nicola is working on, you're working on a front end for it with the AngularJS, is that right?
Cool.
Which is then going to talk to an API, which is going to be exposed by this application.
Is it a hypermedia API?
I don't know. It might become a hypermedia API. And I don't think we've even worked out like who's going to define what the interface is yet. So, you're going to write the app the way you think it should be, and then we're going to write the interface the way we think it should be, and then
Nick said that
we'll see if it works
together.
Integrate
their app like this. So that's why I started doing it.
Yeah. So we'll see how that goes. So anyway, that's one dimension of it. And I think that's cool because everybody wants to write apps now that just have an API and a JavaScript front end. So this will be an experiment to see how well we can make that work. And then for the database side, what we wanted to do, and am I correct in attributing the impetus for this to you, Paul, but or a couple of you, maybe the Grayson?
I support.
Contingent?
I get it from Brian.
That we wanted to have an atomic database, meaning a database that supports atomic updates. Now, what we mean by this is that when we create a record, obviously we create a record. However, when we update a record, we don't want to do what you normally do in a SQL database, which is to overwrite the values that are there before. We want it to be immutable. In other words, every update should create a new record in the database with a timestamp. And what that means is that, say we start out with a topic for this talk, an atomic record. And then I decide to change the title, and then change something else about it, maybe the description. And then we make a few more changes to it. We could basically see the layering of every single change that we've made to the record for that talk. And we could also ask questions like, well, what was the state of the record for that topic a week ago?
What questions do we have?
So I just want to be really clear and kind of belaboring the point a little bit about what the objective was. Now, I think that in general, this is a very useful thing for many applications. I think as we're all being drawn more into the world of functional programming, the functional program has put a great deal of emphasis on immutability. And this basically makes your database an immutable data store. You're not actually overwriting any data. There is a database that has been developed in the Clojure space called Datomic, which is actually, I believe, kind of a front end that can sit in front of a number of different data stores that provides this functionality in the Clojure world and in the Java world. But what we thought we would like to do is to try to do this with Groovy, to try to do this with ActiveRecord. So, in thinking about how to, first of all, are there any questions about what the objective is? And does anybody want to say anything further about why this is a good idea? Yeah?
I thought of a good use case. We could look at what choices we had when we assembled an agenda. So people could be like, oh, that was a really bad agenda. It's like, well, these are the only choices we had.
Okay.
Because we could see what they were.
Let's go back, kind of archaeologically figure out what went wrong. Okay. Yeah. And I think that it helps with addressing issues of concurrency. You could for also, it would also be very helpful if you were trying to implement an optimistic blocking scheme, because one thing that you could do with an optimistic blocking scheme would be to keep track of the last version of a record that you read, and then you maybe may do some work, you make some updates to it, and then you're going to write it back to the database, and you could then check to see whether the version, the current version in the database, is the same as the version that you read before you started working on the changes. Now, in an ordinary SQL database, people often implement that, but I believe they actually do it by having to go along field by field and see if all of the records have the same content. But if you're doing this for this atomic database, then all you have to do is to see if you're looking at the same, if the current record is the same as the one that you pulled out by just comparing a single identifier. So having decided that we wanted to do this, it's totally overkill for the topics application, obviously, but it is probably a useful exercise because we're going to learn a lot. The question was, how do we want to do this with active record? Well, when we want to add some functionality to a piece of software that already exists, we sort of have to think about how deeply do we want it to be embedded into that software, and also what kind of interface do we want to be able to use. So I guess one approach would be to say, okay, we would like to be able to use active, we would like to create a new thing called atomic record that works exactly the way active record does, except in terms of the usability. So that your model class would just inherit from atomic record base instead of active record base. And otherwise, all the code that you wrote would be exactly the same in your application, except that you have this additional functionality of actually not overwriting any of your not having any of your updates overwriting data. So that would be like maybe the ideal. And then there would be another approach, which would be to basically make this a module that sits completely outside of active record and outside of your database, which probably has some advantages from the standpoint of being quite testable independently. And in fact, when we were first considering this, I think that was the direction the project was headed. In other words, we were going to write a service class, we actually created a place for it in this hierarchy under CRUD services, which would, and we have a create service, a read service, an update service, and I haven't finished delete, where basically all we would be doing is pulling all of the records, all of the versions of a particular record from the database, and then having our software that's sitting in front figure out which is the most current one. But then, in that case, we lose a lot of the functionality that's available through the database, because we would like to be able to do joins, for example. But if we have to pull out all of the data to figure out which is the most recent, then we can't, it's very difficult to go back to the database and use the database engine to do what it's good at, which is doing possibly multi-way joins among different tables representing relational data. Then, so So I think that the first approach that I suggested was kind of an attractive one. But what I worked on in the last week, and Alex and Brian and I and a couple other people, I think you were there too, we're discussing at Hack Night, was maybe use this framework of the CRUD services to implement what we wanted to do, but to maybe use this as sort of a proving ground with the idea that possibly after we were done with it and had it working, we could then see how we could take this and push it back into a little bit deeper, more deeply integrated with Active Record so that we could have that initial objective. So I guess the other thing with this is in terms of the database schema, how do we want this to work? So we insert a record, and then we want to make an update to it. So somehow we need to create a new record to represent the update, but we also have to somehow preserve the fact that both of those rows refer to the same entity, in other words, the same logical record representing the same logical row from the database. So what we wanted to do with that is to use a UUID, universal, what does it stand for?
Universal
unique identifier with UUID as a database column. But we didn't really want it to be in that table because we still don't want to have to be changing anything in any of the rows that we inserted. So what I came up with as an idea is for each table to have a companion table that holds the UUID representing a particular logical row in the table, in the logical table, together with another column that has the value of the auto increment ID that is generated for the row that actually holds the data in the table. So to see what that actually looks like, let's look at the Active Record migration for create topics. So we're actually going to create two tables here. One is a topics table, and you notice here that as far as Active Record migration is concerned, I said ID is false, which means that I don't want Active Record migration to auto create an ID column that is auto increment for this table, because actually we're going to use the UUID as the primary key, and then this other field called topic ID will actually hold the auto increment value of the companion table called EXT topics that holds the actual data. So you see we have our topics table with the UUID representing the record, a topic ID, which is basically a pointer into this table. And this table, you notice, you don't see an ID column here, but because this is Active Record migration, and I haven't specified anything to the contrary, I'm going to get automatically from Rails an ID column with auto increment. And then I've specified the actual fields that we're interested in, the title of the talk, the description of the talk. And we also put into this extended topics table the UUID, which will help to tie it back to the base topics table. that is kind of like the, holds the pointer to the most recent record. So in terms of navigating between the topics table, and the, which is really the base topic, it's almost like the metadata table, and the extended topics, which is your real topics table, which holds your real data, the way you navigate here is to go from, if you're looking at a topics record, you follow the topic ID to pull out the row, which is the current row in the extension topics table. But if you're looking at a row in the extension topics and you want to know what the base topic is, then you can follow the UUID back to the base topic. Okay? Now, I've actually generated these tables in Postgres, and just for fun, we can look at what these look like in Postgres. So let's just do this. PSQL, the name of the table is Podium, the name of the database is Podium Development. Since I'm using a domain socket, I don't actually put the right things in the configuration file. I don't need to actually provide any authentication to sign into this. And so then I can go /D and look at topics. So there's the same thing we just looked at in the migration. We have an integer topic ID, the UUID, that we also put the deleted. We keep track of whether the record's deleted in the base table. And then we have a created add and updated add that were generated automatically courtesy of Rails migration. And then we put two indices on this table. A unique index on the topic ID and a unique index on the UUID. And then the other table here is ext topics. And that has, there we can see now our ID field, the title description, the UUID. We let Rails put its own created, add, and updated in for that. And then in this case, we have a primary key index on extended, on the ID column, which was generated by the migration. And then we also specified in the migration explicitly another unique index on the UUID. So there you can see it in the database. Now, what we've done in the, what I've then done is to create two modules here, which I have derived as extensions of Active Support Concern. That just produces some boilerplate code, as you know, that sort of automates the include and extend paradigm for Ruby module inclusion in a way that supports nesting in the right way and gives you some additional syntactic sugar like this included do. So when this module, atomic base, is included in our active record model class, we're going to define the primary key to be the UUID. And then I've created some helper methods just to generate, like if this is included into the topic model class, the first one named class will return topic, the extension class method will return ext topic. It will also generate a foreign key and the name of the extension table, which then I need in some of the additional methods. And then, in order to hook the topics table with the extension table, we can just use the basic machinery that already comes for free from Active Record. We can say that topic, which is the table that will include this module, has many versions represented by extension class with a foreign key of UUID, and that this topic also belongs to its data. This is a one-to-one relationship, really. This belongs to its data, which is an extension class. And the association is formed through the foreign key, which we're, in this case, going to call topic ID. Then we can basically make the join that we would like to have happen occur automatically behind the scenes by creating a default scope for this class. So the default scope includes data, which is the most recent extent, which is the current version of the extension class. And then I've also added to the scope where deleted is false, so that default scope will actually just return. But we can do all our work with the topic class and do our queries with the topic class, and the result that we get back is actually going to be, in most cases, exactly what we want, which is the current record and no deleted records. I also created a history method, which would actually give you all of the versions by joining the versions by joining this table to the versions association. And then if a UUID is provided, we would just get the versions for that particular UUID, which identifies a specific record. Then, in order to further the illusion that you're just dealing with a single table instead of two tables, I put in a method missing here, so that if we attempt to access a field like title or description in the extended table, before giving up, we will first check to see whether self.data, which is the extension table, supports that method. And if that also throws in a method error, then we will throw up our hands and send it up to super, which will probably just return the same error. Okay? I think it would be nice, instead of having the method missing, to actually write a little bit more complicated metaprogramming that would extract the methods that actually exist and include those in this class. But this was kind of the quick and dirty approach, and very similar to what I was talking about earlier with the find by methods in earlier versions of Rails, where they basically implemented those with method missing. Method missing has various issues, including some security problems, because one of the parameters that it takes is a block that you can pass into it. And if your implementation of method missing basically executes the code that's passed in the block, you can basically get method missing to do anything that you want. And then we also, in the base topics class, I created a created method which returns the created at from the base row, because if we always want the created time to be the time that the logical record was first created, and then an updated, which actually looks at the created at value of the data, because the created at value of the data is actually going to be the time of the last update to the logical table. Then there's another class. So this class here is called Atomic Base. And then I have another module called Atomic Extension, which basically is just the other side of this. This is the module that you include in your extended topics class. So if we actually go back and look at the definition of the model, somewhere up here, here we are. Here's a topic. So very simple, just includes a topic base. And extension topic just includes atomic extension. And actually this stuff with the updated and created was some code that was originally written, I think, in an earlier implementation. And we've now pushed that up into the included module. So that's all there is there. And then we have a service class, several service classes. So let's look, for example, at the create service. So the way that we create a record here is not as nice as just topic.create. Bang with a hash after it. I think that would be the objective if we take the code that we've written and push it down into a gem that we can just use the same way that we use an active record. Let me just show you very briefly, because we're running close to the end of the time here, how we create one of these classes. We actually do, let's do Rails console. Okay, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to say a topic T is equal to, I'm going to do CRUD topics create dot new. So that's how I invoke the create topics service within the CRUD service package. And then I have to pass into this a hash that maybe I give it the title is my talk, and the description is,
you have a typo in the
description. Question. Yeah, that's good to catch that. Is that right now?
Looks good.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then we basically have this. This is how we make our service request, and then we just do dot call. And that generates our topic. And so here we have T dot data, for example, has the title and the description. I can do t.title, and it returns my talk. t.description, and it returns the description, right? Similarly, if we wanted to do an update, let's say we wanted to update is equal, again, instead of just being able to change the parameters and calling update, we have to go through this service layer. U is equal to CRUD topics update, and then update dot new, and here the initializer is going to take two variables, t for the record that we're looking to update, and then a hash of other things. So let's say title is a more detail at the way the service is implemented. And I think we're almost out of time here, so I'll try to wind this up in a minute or so. Up at the top, the first three lines of the CRUD create service have these things called attribute defaultable. That's not a Rails thing, that's an originate slash Alex thing. It's a little gem called attribute defaultable. It's only a few lines of code. It's very similar to attribute accessor, except as you can see, it allows you to specify a default value in a lambda. And it seems maybe a little bit pedantic, except it's actually very useful for dependency injection, which is what he uses it for, because he's written some tests that use mocks. And when you use mocks, the trick is dependency injection becomes an issue because you need to kind of substitute your mock classes for the things that they're mocking. And this gives them a way to kind of a handle to do that. The important thing here is the call method. As you can see, we start an active record-based transaction. We're using Postgres database, which supports transactions. So we're generating a UUID. We are adding that to the parameters by doing a reverse merge. And then we're calling the extended resource factory, which is just our ext topic class, calling create on that, passing the parameters, getting back a row, and then reading the ID attribute out of the row and passing that as the topic ID along with the UUID to the resource factory.create method, which creates the base record. And as you can see, update is very similar to that. It just follows a slightly different sequence because you already have a record that already contains the UUID. And then you're going to be just updating that base record. So down at the bottom in the last line here, we're doing an update to the base class, to the base row table name, resetting the row attribute. You might wonder why I wrote the SQL. It was just some problem getting it working with active record update. So just wanted to make it work. And it worked. So that's it. If you're interested in going into more details in this, come along to Hack Night next Wednesday. We'll probably poke through some more of this. We'll have a little bit more of this written. And I think I'm sufficiently pleased with the way this has turned out. I think it'll be fairly easy to take this code that we've written in these services and push what's going on in these call methods in creating and update down into maybe a before create or before update handler in Active Record. And that would enable us to basically put everything back into Active Record in a way that uses the external interface of Active Record but doesn't make assumptions about the internals. So I hope this has been interesting, and I hope you'll join us in producing the Podium app.
Sounds great. Thanks, Tom.